Hello, my name is Dr. Sandra Magnus, and I am an astronaut class of 1996 mission specialist. And so I was an astronaut for 16 years, and in that time frame, I had an opportunity to fly on three missions. And it was a whole lot of fun, because two of them were short-term missions, shuttle flights to the space station, where we did assembly, and one of them was a shuttle mission which took me up to the station, and I got to stay for 4.5 months, and then I came back down on a different shuttle. So it's been a lot of fun. You know, it was really funny, because when I dreamed of being an astronaut, I knew there was training, and I knew I had to do some things, but there were things that I did during training that I never imagined that I would be doing. It was like being on a Disney ride the whole time, my whole career, learning how to parachute. You know, before you learn shuttle systems, they teach you T-38s if you haven't ever flown before, or even if you have, everybody trains up on T-38s. And I never imagined I was going to learn how to fly a jet aircraft. So in order to fly the jet aircraft, you have to do survival training. You have to learn how to do parachute falls. So here I was in the middle of Oklahoma, and they were teaching us how to land, you know, and fall correctly on a parachute. And then they took us parasailing behind a pickup truck. And so you're in a harness, and there's this truck, and you got a parachute attached to you, and the truck starts to drive, and you're running behind the truck, and the parachute is filling up with air behind you, and eventually it lifts you up off the ground. So it's like parasailing, but behind a truck. And there were moments like that through my whole career. I was like, I'm doing what? And they're paying me to do this? And that was just one that I thought was always rather amusing, that I'm, you know, running across this field with a parachute on my back waiting to get picked up in the air. But yeah, there's tons of moments like that. But it was always fun, because there were always things that I was doing that I never thought I would do. And it was always kind of an interesting challenge to see how well I could adapt to it. You know, we did a backpacking trip, not the outdoor leadership school. They sent shuttle crews on to sync up our team faster. And I'd never had done backpacking before. It's like I discovered I enjoyed backpacking about halfway through my life. It's like, oh, this is great. Yeah, so I had a lot of opportunities like that. Living in Russia forever, I spent a huge amount of time in Russia. The opportunity to live in another country and learn another language and immerse yourself in a different culture. These are things I never imagined when I was that middle school girl dreaming of being an astronaut that I would get to do, in addition to, oh, by the way, going to space. So it's been really great. Well, you know, it's interesting. I think the thing that hits me to this day is the difference between a shuttle mission, where you're there short term and you're very busy and your head's down and you think you're enjoying space and you think you're adapting to space, but you really don't know that you haven't until you live there. Because when you live there, I was there for 4.5 months, you adapt to space to a whole nother level. And you really internalize the environment. Because when you're up there, Newton's laws drive, you know, action, reaction, bodies in motion tend to go in motion until you're acted on by an external force. You internalize that, you live that. And you get so comfortable with it, you don't even think about it. And it was very funny when STS-119 came to pick me up. And you can ask Steve about this when you talk to him next. They docked and we opened the hatch. And those guys came through the hatch and they were very awkward looking. They were very tentative. They were pushing off very slowly. They looked like they were clumsy. It's like a 2-year-old walking for the first time, right? And I was looking at them going, wow, I've really adapted to being on orbit. And it struck me that, wow, there's such a difference between just visiting and living there. And you go to a whole nother level and you don't even realize it. So that was really surprising. Yeah, so let me go back to where we started. You know, I had the plan to go through physics because I didn't know that there were other opportunities open to me. So the Science Center, I think, does a really good job of remaining accessible to a wide range of people so that students can come here and they can see what the possibilities are. It can open their eyes to what kind of careers they might like. It can open their eyes to what kind of areas of inquiry that they enjoy, or that they even like that kind of thing. It shows them the possibilities. And I think there's nothing more powerful you can bring to a young person than to broaden their mind and show them what they can do. Because again, you can't choose something that you don't know exists. So having a center like this that's easily accessible to a wide range of people brings those potentials and those possibilities to those young people. And that is really a great thing. Yeah, I hate hearing that. I hate hearing kids say, oh, you know, I can't be good at math, or girls aren't good at math, or people like me aren't good at math because my parents aren't good at math. Or that's that's self-defeating. You can do anything when you put your mind to it. Yeah, we all have different strengths and weaknesses. I am a very poor artist. You know, I am a music appreciator, but I can dabble a little bit. And determination covers a lot. So you can be good at science. You can be good at math if you'd work hard enough. Don't let anybody talk you out of doing something. Don't talk yourself out of doing something. So, and I would argue that different students, different people learn different ways. And perhaps you're struggling because someone's not teaching, it's not being taught you in the way that you need to learn it. So explore different avenues of learning. Stress relief for me is exercise. On the weekends, I usually exercise a little bit more than I was required to. I had movie nights. I don't know if you talked to Mike Fink, but we would have movie nights. He and I flew together on Expedition 18. Movie nights, you could call people. You can actually make phone calls. And it's always fun to call people from space because they freak out. It's like, space calling, what? You know, that was always fun. You had email exchanges. I like to read, but I didn't read in space because I can read on the Earth. So I didn't want to waste time doing something there that I could do at home. I took a lot of pictures. You can't help it. You look out the window, it's like, wow, I got to take a picture of that. Oh, I got to take a picture of that. Which, of course, then means you have to sort through all your photos, and that's very time consuming. I also spent a lot of time, because I'm anally organized, I got personal satisfaction out of reorganizing messy areas of the station. Because I don't know if you know how it works, but we have gazillions of pieces of equipment up there. And we have an inventory system that runs off a barcode. And so theoretically, when someone puts a piece of equipment away, they're barcoding where it went, and there's different locations. And for that system to work, people have to always put things back where they get them from. Right? So that's really hard for human beings to do that. So over time, there's things that get lost. And one of the things that can slow you down the most on space station is if it says, okay, go get these pieces of equipment to do your job, and you go to the places where the equipment's supposed to be, and the equipment's not there. Because then you go on a scavenger hunt. And so every now and then they need people to go through and just sort of try and find things and put them back where they belong. And I did a lot of that. Yeah, so the SRMS, usually there's two people involved in flying the shuttle robot arm, the Canada arm. One person is sort of helping with the cameras, and you usually have camera displays here. You can look out the window and see things, but of course you can't get a fully three-dimensional view, so you augment with cameras. And so in your mind, you're putting together three-dimensional picture of where the arm is going. And you practice this, of course, so you know exactly what camera views you need, at what time. You've got a procedure that tells you where to point the cameras. You and your partner have worked this out, and so your partner is going through the checklist and reminding you what's coming next and keeping track of where all the knobs and the dials and all that stuff is, and watching the cameras. And you're really, when you're flying the arm, you are focused on flying the arm. You are focused on understanding exactly where it's going. You are focused on making sure it's doing what it's supposed to do and nothing else. And so it's very mentally demanding, because you have to be very focused. Whether you're the person who's doing the procedures and running the cameras, or whether you're the person who's actually floating around here flying. And so you have the two controllers, and there's usually a foot loop on the floor. You can anchor yourself, and you kind of anchor yourself with part of your hand as well up here. So you can very lightly and gently move the hand controllers, the translation and the rotation in each place. And then your partner is, you're changing modes occasionally. There's different ways you fly the arm based on the reference point, and based on the coordinate system that's easily usable to get the picture in your mind of what you're trying to do. And you train a lot over and over and over again, whether it's something you're picking up out of the payload bay and moving around, or whether you have an astronaut on the arm and you're flying them around, because they'll be giving you verbal instructions as well. And that's usually the more challenging flying, because when you have somebody on the end of the arm, you train a lot for it, but when they get out there in the real environment, they might need to deviate from where they thought they needed to be. And so you have to freeform where you're going and how you're going to do it. So that the really big thing there is the communication between you and the person on the arm, that you're speaking in the same coordinate system, which could be an internal coordinate system, so that this is 000, or there's a 000 point somewhere in the payload bay that you're referencing. But understanding which coordinate system you're in is very important. Well, on STS-112, we had the S-1 truss in the cargo bay, which was the first starboard truss, and it had the radiators on it. So if you go look at a picture of the space station, you know, this is the pressurized modules, and you know, the truss comes across, and there's the S0 truss, and then on the right side of the station, there's the S1 truss, and there's three silver kind of radiators come off it. We took that up, and so we attached that. We actually used, though, the station arm for that. So we were on the station using the Canada arm on the station, and we, again, two people do it, so I say we. So I flew it, and my partner was doing the procedures. And so we went and grabbed it and spun it around and attached it. And then we had several spacewalks, and we flew the spacewalkers around on the arm. On my second mission, we picked up the MPLM, which was a pressurized cargo module that sat in the payload bay. And the purpose of that was to bring cargo up to the station. So you pick it up out of the payload bay, attach it to the hatch in the station, and then you open the hatch and you move stuff around. And then on the mission that came to pick me up on station, we picked up the last solar array out of the shuttle bay and attached it. And then the last mission that I was on completely was another cargo mission. So